Doctor? Doctor, come quickly!
The calendar!
Alright, Callum.
Yeah?
Question time.
Okay.
Why did Cersei order the Stark's direwolf to be executed?
Cause she's a massive bitch.
She has no sense of humor. Just gonna let that one sink in. Let the blood boil a bit. And
anyway, welcome.
Yes, welcome to day 15. Day 15 of the Genesis of Andrew's Island. Yeah, we're coming over 2022. We are doing Game of Thrones Season 4, Episode 7. Mockingbird. Last time we had Tyrion's trial. Where he said, there was enough poison for the pack of you. I would gladly give my life.
I wish I was the monster you thought I am.
I would gladly give my life to watch you all swallow it. Of course, that's what we were saying to Dave and Dan after season 8. Anyway. Best season ever. Anyway.
Disappointing.
But yeah. But for a split second, I thought you were doing Ryan Sinclair, not Kit Harington. How was it when your nan died? Disappointing. Anyway, after all those events, what are your anticipations going into Mockingbird?
Well, you referenced the fact that that is the sigil, or whatever thing Littlefinger wears. It's something to do with Littlefinger, so this probably would be a quite...
It's the sigil of House Baelish.
Yeah, sigil, that's the word, yeah. It's the sigil of, yeah. So I'm imagining this will have... a scene that's pretty big to do with Littlefinger, most likely. A central theme around him. I don't know if we'll get the Trialway combat this episode. They'll probably save that for maybe next episode. That seems natural. Other than that, we're kind of in a... We're now obviously in the second half of the... Well into the second half of the season now. And... It has ramped up like I've wanted it to for quite some time since episode 2. Yeah, these last few episodes have slightly picked up the pace, I'd say. So, and last episode having not without its issues, but a little bit more consistent across the board rather than there being, you know, some great scenes and then one bad Daenerys scene. At the very least, there was a little bit more consistency spread across.
To be fair, Daenerys actually had a really good scene in the last episode.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. That was actually a scene where it was what I wanted. There was an actual discussion about her actions that took place, which was nice. I want more of those scenes, you know, because this show so far is pretty good with its dialogue overall, and Daenerys... Like, that whole storyline hasn't really been up to par, but the last episode had a really great scene. More of that, please. But yeah, other than that, I'm expecting some more consistency. So we shall see in this episode. Mockingbird.
Yes. Mockingbird. Yes, the end is indeed nigh for... the Game of Thrones of old, but we are still in the heyday as of now. That's all I have to say is the doomsayer.
Yeah.
And the fortune teller and the town crier. Are you ready for Mockingbird, Callum?
I am.
You fell in love with a whore.
Yes, I fell in love with a whore. And I was stupid enough to think that she had fallen in love with me.
That doesn't work. Look at all those intestines.
Mercy.
Who am I fighting?
Does it matter?
That's a big beefy boy.
Speaking of big beefy brothers.
Wish you well, Wayne.
So do I. That's where the heart is. That's how you kill a man.
Oh. Hello. Oh my god. Bloody hell.
The king's dead. He drank poison wine at his own wedding. The bounty on you is for killing Lannister soldiers.
This day's really not working out the way you planned. Here on your little list. What's your name?
Rouge.
Thank you.
All right.
You're learning.
He seemed very willing to give his name. So as if he didn't read a situation at all. I like the first part of that scene a lot.
This is no place for wild beasts. Lock him away. Or I'll let Hob throw him in tonight's stew.
Ah, go fuck yourself.
Gloves are doe skin. Softer than virgin's thigh.
I sent for you.
I wouldn't say I have a single sort of girl.
She's dim-witted.
If I wanted wits, I'd marry you.
Won't that make for a great song?
I hope to hear them sing it one day.
Oh, that was great. Oh, look at that scenery.
How did you get in here?
Your door is well guarded.
Late at night, anything could happen.
Take off your clothes.
Well, he's in shape.
Well, a sellsword would need to be, you'd think. Especially one that valuable.
That was funny.
Speaking of nudity.
Yeah, more.
Jorah the Andal.
Uh-oh.
Are you here to see our queen? She's in a good mood.
Wow, I actually didn't think they took up. That's actually quite surprising.
Oh, Danny is full of lust. She just doesn't show it.
Rat cunt. Fucking whore.
Don't get drunk. Kidney pie is wonderful.
Thanks. Do my best.
He's back.
A good kidney pie is all about the ingredients. Flour, lard, water, eggs, milk. Easy enough. Nice armor. You a knight?
No.
Oh, so people with armor is usually knights, generally speaking. In King's Landing.
It's nothing, my lady.
You wouldn't be screwing your face up like that if it was nothing.
Don't want to offend, my lady. Truly, I don't.
You're not interesting enough to be offensive.
The Lannisters want Lady.
If you find her, could you give her this? She's like the last one I gave her, but this one turned out better.
Aww.
You were saying?
I mean, true, you shouldn't be telling everybody about you trying to find Sansa. But now I'm hungry for, like, a steak pie. Just thinking about pies.
I imagined you'd be back at the brothel at this hour.
I did spend some time with an absolutely stunning blonde the other day.
every kind of filth down here except the kind I like.
A head twice the size of his body, a tail between his legs, claws, one red eye. The privates of both a girl and a boy.
That would have made things so much easier.
I will be your champion.
Oh, what a great scene.
That was great. Really good scene. Probably the best way you can get away with killing the mountain. So that's pretty smart on his part. Gosh, she hasn't seen snow in years.
Mm-hmm.
You're being stupid.
I said I'd ruin it!
Fucking hell.
Why did you really kill Joffrey? Tell me why.
I loved your mother more than you could ever know. Given the opportunity, what do we do to those who've hurt the ones we love? In a better world, one where love could overcome strength and duty, you might have been my child, but we don't live in that world. You're more beautiful than she ever was.
Lord Baelish.
Call me Peter.
Yeah, she's right there, because of course she is.
Peter!
You wanted to see me, Aunt Lysa?
Oh, God. She's going to try and throw her, probably, but she'll probably mess up. That's my prediction.
Do you know how far the fall is?
No.
You'll find the head sitting on its own. Every hair in place. Blue eyes staring at nothing.
But I have blue eyes.
What happens to people who stand between Peter and me? Look down! Look down! Look down! Look down!
Lysa!
It's hard to feel bad for a psychopath.
Mm-hmm.
Oh God, he's so gonna push her. He's so gonna push her.
I have only loved one woman. Only one. My entire life.
Oh God, this is so...
Your sister.
Bye. Well, got that bang on.
What a fucking savage kill. All right, Em. Your initial thoughts on Mockingbird?
I thought that was a pretty good episode. Not probably fantastic, but some really, really good scenes here and there.
Mm.
That's probably my thoughts. I think compared to last week, last episode, I would say is a bit a notch below what I kind of wanted following up, but I think there are some scenes, especially in the aftermath of the trial. I think there's one scene in particular that I'm thinking that was pretty excellent.
It's certainly a transitional episode for the most part and mm-hmm. very character focused.
Yes. Yes, indeed.
But I kind of echo your sentiment. I actually... See, here's the problem, right? With a lot of the season 4 episodes, it'll be mostly really solid, then there'll be like one or two pretty glaring issues. I think this episode is kind of the opposite, where there's just a whole bunch of very small issues throughout, rather than any big ones.
Mm-hmm.
It's pretty...
Yeah.
It's a good episode, but it's a little wonky all the way through. And then there's a few scenes that are highlights.
Yeah. That's pretty much what I'm thinking.
I'm going to start with Jaime and Tyrion Lannister. Because that's kind of how the episode started. So I sort of addressed this in, I think it was Breaker of Chains as well, but I think I can address this in full now that we have all the context. There's a big problem with Jaime not volunteering for the Trial of Combat, and the reason they give is, oh, it's because he can't fight. But it disregards the idea that if Jaime put himself forward, there's no way that Tywin would let it go through. There's no way that Tywin would let the Mountain kill Jaime Lannister. And they should be smart enough to know that. Now, the reason why this isn't an issue in A Storm of Swords is because Oberyn Martell, who ends up being the champion, volunteers before Jaime and Tyrion can even talk about it. Oberyn, during the trial, suggests, well, if you, I will volunteer. You know, he almost instantly volunteers for Tyrion in the books, and that avoids that conversation of Jaime volunteering instead. But instead in the TV show, what they did is they decided to have him do that after. And it creates this weird thing of Jaime's, you know, Jaime and Tyrion aren't tactically thinking, well, what is the possibility of, you know, well, if I just do it anyway, there's no way that father would let me die. Like, that's something that they should have considered at the very least. Like, even if say Tyrion said, oh, father wouldn't let you die, and just have Jaime say, I don't think I know what father wants anymore, or something like that. Like, there's a way you could have addressed that, but they just don't. And it makes, I think it especially makes Tyrion seem a lot less smart than he is for him not to realize that, because it's a pretty obvious tactical decision, especially because he's trying to desperately come up with, you know, a champion for his trial by combat. And the only real thing they address is the fact that he's lost his hand and he won't be able to beat the Mountain in a sword fight, which is true. But the, you know, that one thing is a bit of an issue, I think. Then there's also there's also the fact that Tyrion believes that Shae didn't love him,
which it is. It's
not really true, and I don't know why he believes that.
From what he should, the first thing he probably should think is that she was mad about what happened, rather than it being a case of, no, the reason she's doing it is because she was, but then thought he didn't want her anymore.
Yeah.
That was the clear, in terms of what's being presented to us, that's the clear motivation for Shae.
Yeah, and I think it's a bit strange that Tyrion didn't pick up on that.
Yeah, that doesn't work at all. I said again, that as soon as he said it, I just said it, and that didn't work.
And again, it would work had they gone with, actually, Shae never loved him. That would have been so much better, not only for what I just said in the last episode, but also for this one. If he said that and it was actually true, it would be so much better.
Yeah.
So those two, like, weird things do make Tyrion a lot less smart than he should be. And I think that's a bit of a tism.
Well, yeah, it's very clear that that scene was, like, pretty apparent with that line. They just put the scene from the book into that and didn't think about changing it to suit the actual how it's presented, like, with Shae. But they didn't do that, which is a pretty annoying issue.
Having said that, I think the actors sell that scene really well.
Yeah, I think the interaction in terms of them was, like, talking to each other was actually pretty good. I just think the actual meat of it was not in line with what we've come to learn about these characters.
I really like the moment where Tyrion said, you know, you can do all these things, you can fuck your sister, and Jaime's smile fades and he says, careful, I'm the last friend you've got. Exactly. So yeah, that leads to, you know, Tyrion believes it's going to be Meryn Trant, but of course, no, it's actually the Mountain, Gregor Clegane, who's been recast. He's a different actor again. So we had an actor from season one, and then we had one from season two, and then he didn't appear in season three, and now we've got another actor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He's a Scandinavian bodybuilder. So, yes, Cersei has... Because
he looks nothing like the guy from season one.
Oh god, no. And oh, nothing like the guy from season 2 either. The guy from season 2 is completely different entirely. Like, he's like full, like, he doesn't even look remotely similar apart from the height.
Yeah, very different person.
Yeah. But of course, you know, Cersei has recruited the Mountain to be the champion against Tyrion. One question I have is that why were those people... Why was he chopping up those people? Like, was that some kind of practice thing?
I guess these are, like, prisoners who are, like, meant to be killed, I guess, and it's just like, well, we'll just use them for practice.
Right. Okay.
That's a fair inference,
I suppose.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was... it was interesting, for sure. Then we got...
Very strange.
Then we got the second scene with Tyrion, which was with Bronn, and I actually really, really liked this scene with Bronn. I thought that was fantastic.
I thought it was great. I thought the scene was really good.
Yeah, I loved it. They sort of... it's almost like they paid off all of their character from seasons 1 to 3 here. You know, saying, like, I can't fight for you. Yeah. And Bronn was honest. The Mountain's fucking massive and has a big, massive sword. How am I supposed to beat him, you know?
He was he probably thinks, I could probably, there's a chance, but it's not worth the risk. Why would I risk it
with
what
this
I
is,
have now?
This is not the same as one of the Knights of the Vale. The Knights of the Vale could be out, you know, he was pretty confident with that. But when it comes to the Mountain, the risk and reward, and also, back in season 1, Bronn didn't have much, did he? He was, you know, whereas now he's got a small castle with a wife that, you know, if he kills her sister, she'll be heir to that castle.
Mm-hmm.
So he's doing pretty well for himself right now.
Yeah, he's doing very well, indeed. So why would he risk it?
And I really like how I love the respectfulness at the end of sort of just like, you know, you're an evil, cold bastard, and that's why I liked you in the first place. And they shake hands. And you can clearly see Bronn doesn't want to show it, but he does actually care about Tyrion a lot.
Well, he likes him. Because, you know, they bonded pretty well over these last 3 seasons.
And this is actually one of the things that I like about, well, at least until we get to season 8, this is one of the things I actually like about Bronn's character, is that he claims to care about money and that he's a sellsword and that's his only...
There's a little bit more to him.
Motivation in life. But under all of that, you can clearly see he actually does genuinely care about Tyrion Lannister.
Yeah. There's a bit more to him than probably even he thought at first.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And he's almost in denial about how much he genuinely cares about him. As a friend, right? Not just about his money.
Yeah.
And you can tell because there's that thing of like, you know, they'll have songs sung about me when I, you know, at my execution, and Bronn says, I hope to hear them sing it one day, you know, out of respect.
Oh, that was a great line.
I really liked that. And then that leads us to what's probably my favorite scene from the episode, which is with Oberyn Martell and Tyrion.
Yeah.
That
was
so,
a really good scene.
Yeah. So obviously, aside from the Jaime tisms with the fact that Oberyn doesn't do this before Jaime gets to talk to him, the actual character motivation of Oberyn behind this and how that links to Tyrion and the way he told that story about when he was a kid and they traveled from Dorne to Casterly Rock, told about this hideous little beast that had been born, and then they see him and he says, you know, there's no tail, and it wasn't a beast, it was just a baby. And how, like, he grew to hate the Lannisters. Not just, obviously, it was the biggest thing was the fact that the Mountain, you know, killed his nieces and nephews and raped his sister and killed her with their blood on his hands. And he's out for revenge against the Mountain. But also just the way that he saw how wronged Tyrion was by his family. It's almost like he's fighting for him as well. It's like this perfect opportunity for him to jump in because he sees that, you know, this person clearly didn't commit the crime and also the champion that he's fighting against is someone that I want revenge with. So if I think for Oberyn's character, it was perfect for him to be Tyrion's champion.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And I love Pedro Pascal in his performance, you know, that I will be your champion. And the way he tells the story about Tyrion being a disappointment and a hideous monster, and like Peter Dinklage's facial expressions, like with all the emotion and hatred and just all the different things going on in his head. And then the sheer emotion and relief when he hears him say, I'll be your champion as well. So good.
Oh, yes. Very good scene.
Absolutely. Yeah, so that was probably my favorite thing about the episode, the Tyrion and Oberyn scene. But of course, this was a very Clegane-centered episode, because not only did we have the Mountain reintroduced, but we also had scenes with the Hound as well, and Arya.
Yes, we did.
So, okay, so we got... This is the thing about the Hound and Arya, is that they rearrange a lot of stuff, and they've had to add in a lot of stuff to their storyline to fill it out, because I mean, I can't really tell you why that is yet, but like, the, do you remember the Tickler from Harrenhal in season 2, and how he was killed by the Faceless Man, who wore Warjack and Hagar's face? The Tickler was the character who had the rat bucket and was asking questions about the Brotherhood Without Banners, and they were also looking for Gendry as well.
Mm-hmm.
And then the Faceless Man killed him.
He did, yeah.
So in A Clash of Kings, he doesn't kill the Tickler, he kills other Lannister soldiers, and the Tickler is... Basically what happens is the Tickler ends up where Pollivar is. You remember at the start of the season when they went to that inn and they killed Pollivar and all those other people and ate the chickens and took the pony and whatnot? Because in that part of the Storm of Swords, when they go to that thing, the Tickler is also there. And then there's the way, because there's also in this episode, we get a scene that references another character they met, that Arya met on the King's Road, which was Rorge, who was part of, he was also in the same prison cell as the Faceless Man. And he, you know, made threats to Arya as well. But like the way he dies in the book happens different to what it is here. But they kind of had to have him die. So what they did was they had it done here instead. Like they kind of rearranged where he died. Because one of the reasons why they had to do that is because of what they did with Gendry in season 3. Like, you remember how the Red Woman took Gendry to Dragonstone?
Yeah, she did.
Halfway through it? Well, in obviously in the novels, they don't do that. They have Edric Storm go to Dragonstone, who's also a bastard of Robert Baratheon. And Gendry kills Rorge when he's with the brother with her without banners, right? But of course he can't do that in the TV show because he's not there. So instead what they had Rorge turn up here and they had Arya kill him instead.
Yeah.
And I guess it sort of tied into the scene, because it was in the same scene as the dying man, and they did the whole allegory of the sort of wear your heart on your sleeve, which is what the Mountain believes in. And then Arya sort of copied his action when she killed Rorge by stabbing him and then wiped her needle on his arm. Yeah, I think it's a bit of a half and half scene, isn't it? That one.
Well, yeah, I really liked the first half of the scene, and then the second half felt weird. It just felt kind of out of nowhere,
It was very tacked on, wasn't it?
He just kind of let them kill him. He just sort of stood there and let them kill him.
Yeah.
Which was really strange. Like, there's a, what's your name? And he willingly gave her his name.
I mean, Roj is, he was never characterized as being, like, smart per se, but I don't think he was ever shown as being literally this dim-witted.
No, I don't remember much about him in the show, at least.
No, like, he doesn't get too much to do in the show. He is
no,
there.
No, so there's not really anything to suggest
present.
Otherwise.
He is present during the first half of season two, but his characterization is pretty minor in the TV show.
Yeah, so I don't really have anything to really suggest, like, he would be that stupid to just stand there and not defend himself.
Yeah.
Very strange scene.
Yeah.
Second half, anyway.
Although, it did lead to I thought was a great scene for the Hound, especially, was when they were by the fire and she wanted to repair his wounds with fire, but he refused to, obviously, because of his trauma. And he told Arya the story about what the Mountain did to him, which again was fitting because this episode reintroduced the Mountain. So I think it was fitting to do that in the same episode. And I really thought Rory McCann sold that well when he told that whole story in his performance. This was one of the first times we've properly seen the Hound, like, not obviously during the Blackwater when he saw the wildfire, he was full of fear and agony, and he sort of opened up to Sansa a bit. But this is one of the first times we've properly seen the Hound be vulnerable and humanized, I guess you could say. Not just full of piss and vinegar and humor, like, he was genuinely quite sort of emotional about remembering back to when his brother pushed him into the fire for something he didn't do wrong, and then how his father took his brother's side and how that's shaped his life.
Yeah, I thought it was a really well performed scene.
Yeah, I also think that there was also one other thing about that storyline that I thought could have been done better. I feel like, because this is the episode where Arya and the Hound found out that Joffrey died, I feel like there was a
They didn't really say anything about that.
You'd imagine that the reaction from both of them at that news should be a lot more major than it was.
Especially to Arya, the person who killed Ned Stark is the reason Ned Stark's dead, and she sort of had the reaction of, like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. Which is really strange.
But both those characters hated Joffrey with like a burning passion. So you would imagine they'd be pretty ecstatic at that news.
Oh yeah, especially Arya. Mm-hmm. Like, that's her whole thing as a list.
I mean, Joffrey basically treated the Hound like his slave for ages.
Yeah, for a good two seasons.
Yeah. So yeah, I thought those scenes were a bit of a mixed bag, really.
Yeah, I agree. Very much.
Then we got a bit at the wall with Jon specifically, and I suppose the main, clash was between him and Alyssa Thorne about what to do about Mance Rayder, and sort of the argument of, you know, should we block the tunnels or not? To just sort of emphasize who's making the decisions around the sort of the corrupt nature of the fact that they don't have Mormont there. You know, they don't actually have an official Night's Watch leader. I think one of the things that really stood out to me with this was how I think Othel Yarwick, who is a head of the Builders, actually agreed with Jon based on the way he was reacting. I think what he genuinely believed was that Jon was right, but he was too scared to say that because he feared Alyssa Thorne.
That's how I, because I thought at first he was probably going to say, and the way they presented in terms of direction and everything, that he did agree. But yeah, he very much had the look of a man who is kind of scared to speak out truthfully against him. So yeah, that's interesting. Interesting to note.
Mm-hmm. Of course, Alyssa Thorne threatened to, you know, cook Ghost up in a stew as well.
Yeah. What a lovely man.
And then, of course, the slimy Jane Oslint suggesting that, you know, Jon Snow, you should be on the front lines given that, you know, Mance Rayder is your good friend.
Always loves plying little bits of just like being a little shit.
Drawing attention away from him is what he's doing mostly.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah. And of course, Sam had to stop John's temper as well. At the frustration of not being able to control it because of his steward role that Mormont gave him.
Hmm. Yeah.
Yes. Then we got a couple of scenes in Meereen. Of course, beginning with Dario Naharis climbing through the window to Daenerys's chambers, private quarters, you could say. So, okay. So, my problem with the way that they portray Daenerys' lustful side in the TV show is that they don't retain the fact that the reason why she feels this way is because she can't help herself. Because here, her lust comes from the fact that she's in a position of power and she just wants it, right? It's just desire. It's just a sort of like, well, that would be something I would enjoy doing. Whereas in the books, because she's, you know, supposed to be 13 years old, it's her going through puberty. And despite the fact that she doesn't actually like Dario Naharis, she can't really control the way she feels about him because she's so lustfully, you know, attracted to him, despite the fact that she's having doubts about him as, you know, one of her confidants. But they don't really translate that weakness of her here. They don't translate her lust as a weakness. They just translate it as a, well, I would like to do that, because that would be nice and fun.
He's good looking and I'm in the mood.
Yeah, I know. It was, and it's like, let's just get drunk and have sex. Like, it doesn't have the actual sort of, Dario Naharis is actually bad for her, but the reason why she keeps him around is because she has uncontrollable lust for him because of the hormones she's going through. Like, that's what's supposed to be happening to her, basically. But yeah, we don't really get that. But I guess the one thing that it does do is that it does inform Jorah Mormont's jealousy.
Yeah, it does. It does. I see what passed in the morning.
Yeah. Dario Naharis is strange because his characterization isn't particularly well developed here, but also Michael Husband is also a very talented actor, so he comes across very charismatic and, you know, well performed. You know, he has the right charm. It's just he likes to kill people and he likes to have sexual intercourse. That's kind of it, really.
He's good at.
He's good at fight. Like, he's kind of like a shitter version of Bronn when you think about it. Because he, on paper, he likes to fight and he likes to fuck, and so does Bronn, except the difference is Bronn actually has a character. And I suppose,
because I know that how good the actor is, and it feels like I've been really disappointed that he's kind of just been there and not done much else, which is really annoying because I know the capabilities of the actor.
Well, there's so much more to this subtext that's supposed to be there than just he's Danny's boyfriend, you know, boy toy character, as opposed to being he is able to manipulate this queen character because he understands that she lusts for him, if you get what I mean. Whereas it feels like the power dynamic is kind of the other way around here, where almost he is sworn to her and he is submissively asking her for what she wants and she's granting him those wishes, if you get what I mean? Rather than he wants the power that she has and he desires that and she gives it to him despite the fact that it's a bad idea because of her lust. Like, that's what it should be, I think. But they kind of flip it the other way around and it doesn't really work as well. And then the second half comes with Jorah, they do briefly talk about the Daria Naharis stuff. So they go down the whole thing of the cell swords are going to reclaim Yunkai, and then her plan is to sort of execute all the slave masters as a sort of quick fix, because that's her brutality ways, I guess you could say. And then Jorah Mormont convinces her to think of an alternative, and then she does. She does the whole thing. Tell him I've changed my mind. Actually, tell him you've changed my mind. I think my thoughts on this is that what it does is it establishes a really good position for Jorah Mormont in her side. The only issue I have is that the actual politics of the Slaver's Bay is so simplified that it almost feels like there should be more to it than just a very simple, I'll do this decision or I will do plan B. That's my only real disappointment with it, is the world building side of it is really poor, but the actual interpersonal character relationship between Jorah and Daenerys was well handled. That's my take on it.
Yeah, I can see that. I feel like I appreciate the fact that there is a little bit more than just Daenerys does what she wants and that's it, and they just give some stern looks and there's no real conversation. I feel like there's a conversation here.
It's not completely vacuous. It's not completely vacuous, no. But it's just the world building side of it isn't complex enough to actually complement the arc she's having. I think it does more to benefit Jorah's character than it does to benefit hers, rather than doing both. Because Jorah Mormont's characterization, it is very centered around the interpersonal relationship that he has with Daenerys and her, you know, all the people that are close to her, and that's much smaller scale compared to the, you know, literal multiple cities worth of kingdoms that she's trying to liberate and run, which is far more, it requires a far more things to discuss than just am I going to make this decision or am I going to make that decision. That's what's really missing, is all of the complexities toppling on her, as opposed to just do I murder all the slave masters or do I give them a choice. And then, even in that, giving them that simple choice is still... The fact that that's enough to make Jorah smile, I still... I don't know if I buy that. Just the sort of, like, you can either live in my one or die in the old one. Like, it's still a very sort of... It doesn't change that much about her. It's like just a slight nudge the other way. Because you know that the slave masters won't be very happy with that. And I think Jorah Mormont should know that too. But I suppose on a personal level, he's happy that she's listening to him rather than the sellsword, which is something, I guess.
Yes, something.
But yeah, no, I think the wheels are falling off a bit with Daenerys. I mean, last episode they did well. The Hisdar Zolarak element was well done, but she's getting less and less screen time as this is going on, and that's a problem.
Yeah, it's only around like two scenes maximum, and even then it never really is that much.
Yeah, I'll leave the rest of the marine stuff to you if you got any other thoughts.
No, I just feel like there's some wasted things surrounding the story, whether it be the narrative or the actors around it. And it's always my least favorite part of the show, with this season, anything to do with Meereen/Daenerys. And while I feel like last episode was a really good step in the right direction, and this had moments of there's something there, but overall it's just not much I can really praise in terms of. Especially in comparison to the rest of the show, which even with this season, with its issues, still has a lot more complexity to it, with a lot more development of characters and narrative in a pretty satisfying and progressive way going forward. This just feels very stagnant and sort of basic for Game of Thrones in a lot of ways.
Yeah, disappointing, really, given how like Marine is in the books is the opposite. It's the most complex storyline of the lot. So yeah. Disappointing that they've downsized that element of it. Because really, it should be all over the show, really, as opposed to just being there every now and then. Because let's not forget, like, she is supposed to be a really major, important character.
Oh, yeah, she absolutely is.
Yeah.
Doesn't feel like it right now.
It definitely feels like they've given the Night's Watch and Jon Snow storyline a lot more love this season than they have Daenerys.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, so then we move on to a scene between the Red Woman, Melisandre, and Selyse Baratheon. I actually did like this scene. It's a scene between two characters that haven't played major roles this season, but I think it was a nice little pocket of the episode that probably, you know, naturally is overshadowed by many other things. But it was a scene between two characters that just have are mostly background, but I really actually quite like the dynamic between them, just the sort of character interaction in this one, because it's sort of what it mainly established was the sort of, like, firstly it was the Red Woman, you know, explaining the how all these potions have placebo effects on men and how they believe that it makes them more powerful and stronger, but actually they are just there for to make you think something that you already can do, which was a really interesting perspective that she has. And it's also the sort of, like, the whole thing of all the fancy bits and bobs that come with religion are just there to aid your focus on the real thing that you need to be looking at. And obviously looking into the flames is the only real access to the Lord of Light that the Red Woman understands. Everything else is just fun and games, really. But the main thing I think that they did really well was they had Selyse saying, you know, did you use those potions on Stannis? And she, when, you know, obviously referencing back to season two when they created that shadow that killed Renly, and Stannis had to be unfaithful to his wife to do so. And I liked how they, the Red Woman said, no, he didn't. You know, men are men and it's just flesh, but it's because men want what they can't have. And then Selyse kind of brings herself back by saying, you know, any service done in the eyes of the Lord of Light is no sin, you know, sort of reassuring herself that Stannis had to do it for the Lord of Light, you know. But even though she clearly feels, you know, feels pain, the fact that her husband had to be unfaithful to her, which I thought was a nice bit of character growth, just sort of to the audience.
Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
And then,
doesn't,
of course,
make her as, like, one note as she's been so far.
Mm. And then, of course, we got the whole thing of she's very established, very not a fan of her daughter, but we had the Red Woman established to her, when we leave here, we have to take her with her because she's part of the Lord of Light's plans. I thought that was really good, sort of just sort of establishing, like, you, because the thing is, you could have just had the scene not exist and you could have had Shireen be taken to where they're going and just had it be, but because they have Melisandre tell Selyse why, or at least not why, but tell Selyse that that is needed to happen, it means that you will have a more natural understanding that the reason why Selyse is allowing it is because the Red Woman suggested it. Not just suggested it, but demanded it because of the Lord of Light's demands. And I think that was necessary to establish, given that we know about, you know, Selyse and what she thinks about her daughter. So I think they did well here. I also think, visually speaking, it was a really well-directed scene, especially with how there was that shot of them standing face to face and we were on the side view and they had different color grading for each sides of their faces. So on Selyse's face it was orange to resemble fire, and then on the Red Woman it was blue to resemble ice. I thought that was a good bit of imagery.
Yeah, it was nice.
Yeah. So yeah, what were your thoughts on that scene?
Yeah, it was actually a pretty well done scene. I'm thinking, yeah, like I said, it adds a little bit more to her character than there's been, because so far she's been very much, I'm a servant of the Lord of Light, I worship the Lord of Light, and that's kind of just been her character. With this little moment that she had, it's something else there, you know, it gives a little bit more depth than probably she's had a whole run. So yeah, mm-hmm. I thought this scene did a pretty decent job at that.
And also there's the, this wasn't spoken in dialogue, but if you notice the actress's performance, like the way she looks at the Red Woman's naked body when she's out of the bath, you can clearly see mm-hmm. that she's sort of like, this is what, you know, my husband desires and I'm not that. And I think that's kind of what she was trying to portray when she was looking at Melisandre, you know, the sort of...
Well, that's why she asked. That's why she asked temptation. About the potion.
Yeah. Despite the sort of, the, I guess, a little bit of jealousy on her part of like, I wish I could be, you know, like this woman. I wish I could be what my husband wants. She also is so dedicated to the Lord of Light that she's willing to, you know, sacrifice her happiness, which is really, it's, it makes her a really quite tragic character when you think about it. The sort of devoted,
almost. Yeah, a little bit, yeah.
Almost like a, I mean, she, I don't know if nun is the right word, but almost just devoted to one religion so hard that it makes life mm-hmm. so damning and difficult for you that you can't even love your own daughter and your husband neglects you and dislikes you even.
Mm.
It's quite tragic in a way. In a way that I almost think that she's just starting, you can see that she's sort of, there's moments where she's becoming self-aware of how tragic her life is, but she always snaps out of it because she's so devoted to the religion. So yeah, there's, I thought this was good character development for Selyse, and I think it gave a really good sort of indicator for Shireen rejoining with Stannis where they go next, because she is needed for the Lord of Light. So yeah, I did like that. Then, of course, we got the scenes with Brienne of Tarth, Podrick Payne, and Hot Pie.
Hmm.
You can talk about this one if you want.
Yeah, it was a nice little surprise. See Hot Pie again, making his pies and his bread. I actually do like the moment where he gave the bread to Brienne, and it was like a direwolf bread. You know, I thought that was a nice little moment. But yeah, I'm enjoying these scenes between Podrick and Brienne. I'm really enjoying them a lot because it's something a little bit different. It's a little bit more cheerful in some ways, but you know, just sort of two characters who are compared to all the political aspects of the show and the higher ups, and they seem a little bit more. A bit grounded, a bit like the Hound and Arya, but in a different mm-hmm. way. So yeah, I don't hate these scenes at all. I'm quite enjoying these kind of scenes, and I really like Podrick. I think he's a nice guy.
Yeah, he's he's a charming fellow, and he means well, but he's also quite clumsy.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's a nice little nugget of the show, just a sort of thing that exists that is so different to everything else. And I like how they established that Hot Pie hears the Stark name and doesn't want to tell them at first because he's scared, because he knows about people will kill for gold. He's also concerned about like, what if these people are from King's Landing and they are on behalf of the Lannisters. What if they find Arya and they kill her? So obviously Hot Pie is, you know, he has, he was close with Arya on the King's Road and at Harrenhal.
Yeah, but I like this little bit of the episode.
Mm-hmm. There's also the Hot Pie, like, speaking enthusiastically about all the ingredients, like, oh, you can't skip out the gravy.
He's not wrong, though. He's not wrong.
He just gravy loves his
and a
food.
Nice steak pie. In a good steak pie, the gravy is quite delicious.
Yeah, he loves his pies. Apparently, the actor who plays Hot Pie has actually got a genuine bakery now, where he makes pies.
Oh, that's awesome. That's funny. That's good. Oh, that's great. That's amazing.
Yep. Yeah, he's got
inspired.
He's got like a massive advertisement for his career all over this show. Product placement.
he probably has one of those singers in the store. I was like, home to the famous Hot Pie, get your pies now or whatever. Something like that. And yeah. It's got the Game of Thrones logo on it.
It's also like kind of nice that he's actually perfected making that direwolf bread as well, because it looked pretty botched last time.
That's why I really quite like that moment. You know, it's a nice little thing there. Always like those little things in the of characters, even minor ones doing those kind of things. Very, very sweet.
Yes, of course. And they referenced Sansa Stark at the Eyrie, which of course means we cut to this, the last section of the episode, which is tied to the title, The Mockingbird. We have Sansa Stark, Robin, Aaron, Lysa Aaron, and Peter Baelish. So it's quite a bit to get into with this one. So the first thing I'll note is that there is one detail missing from this. It is, now this is going to surprise you, because for the most part it's pretty airtight, but there is actually one thing that they cut out in season one with Sansa Stark. It is the, there is a little storyline in the books, in the first book, A Game of Thrones, where she thinks that she got Ned in trouble and she feels guilt for it, even though she didn't. There's like a scene, I can't exactly remember when it is, but there's a scene where she goes and tells someone about him because she's off, you know, having a strop. And then it actually ends up, it's like a red herring. Like, it actually ends up not leading to anything. Like, it doesn't have, there's nothing that she said caused Ned to get into any trouble, right? But she, the important thing isn't that it did, it's the fact that she thinks it did. It's the fact that she thinks that what she said got him caught, and she feels guilt about it because he ended up having his head cut off right in front of her. And part of that scene where she builds the Winterfell castle in the snow at the Eyrie is in a monologue when she thinks about, you know, it was all my fault, thinking about how I got my father killed, even though she didn't. And that's one detail that is missing from this scene, unfortunately. And they can't really do it because she didn't do anything in season one that would cause that, because they cut that from the show. So that is one thing that is missing. But regardless, she still builds the castle and it still has a meaning because it's her home. And then, of course, little Robin Aaron comes in. The spoiled brat. I think what I really liked about this with Robin Aaron is it established how protected he is from the world, and the fact that he's so high up.
Oh yeah.
And the fact that he's
like one of those like extremed homeschool kind of situations.
Yep. And his life has been so insular that he believes genuinely that anything below the area is dangerous. He's been helicopter mummed his whole life. And
pretty much.
Just the way he casually talks about horrible things, it just clearly he just doesn't, he hasn't had the bit, he's had a terrible upbringing and he just doesn't understand the world properly. Of course, this leads to him having a temper tantrum and kicking the snow castle, which leads to Sansa slapping him on the face, which is natural sort of like reactionary behavior for young people to have. But of course, the thing that she forgets in that moment is that if you slap a lord, you can have your hand cut off, which is a big punishment. Of course, that doesn't happen, but it is, again, it is part of it. It's like the sort of, it comes down to the sort of the laws of the Highborn and all that, and how stupid they are. But that kind of leads to this sort of natural cause and effect where Robin obviously runs away to go and tell his mum that Sansa just slapped her. And that would in turn cause Lysa to try and find Sansa. And meanwhile, while that happens, Littlefinger walks in having witnessed this and talks to Sansa about it. And we get this really, really quite interesting performance from Aidan Gillen, I think. Because you get the part where she says, "Why did you kill Joffrey?" And he has that sort of that facial expression he does, and then, "I loved your mother more than anyone." And then he explains, like, you know, what would you do to your worst enemies if you lost the one you love, you know? And that is finally him addressing the Red Wedding, and this is partly his revenge for that, the fact that the Lannisters killed Catelyn, and so this was him, part of him getting back at them for that, which I thought was brilliant. That was a brilliant moment. And just, this is why I love Littlefinger. There's just, there's so many layers to this character. Like, there's things about him that are absolutely diabolical, like the fact that he's a psychopathic murderer. Absolutely. and he's also, like, the way he says, if love had gone powered over duty and, you know, law, then maybe I would have been your father. And it's true, because he loved Catelyn and Ned didn't, but then Ned grew to love Catelyn because they were arranged into a marriage. Yeah. And then you basically see that after the death of Catelyn, Littlefinger has now fallen for Sansa Stark, given that he can no longer have her mother, which is, in turn, like, in the internal logic of Baelish's mind, from what you understand about his character, it all, you understand why he has fallen for her, but it's also, from an outsider's perspective, extremely fucked up and creepy as well.
Oh, yeah.
Because he has basically groomed her. He has groomed her since she was a child. Since season one.
Yeah.
And of course, because Robin would have told his mother about what would have happened, she went to try and find Sansa, and she ended up witnessing the kiss between Baelish and Sansa. Which leads to Lysa trying to kill Sansa through the moon door, and that leads to end up Baelish giving her the cold words of, I loved only one woman, your sister. And then pushes her down and kills her. Mm-hmm. So yeah, anyway, let's sort of cycle back. I've sort of given an outline of that, but what were your thoughts on all the stuff at the Eyrie?
I think everything with Littlefinger I've really enjoyed. Just that his dialogue I thought was pretty excellent. I thought the moment with Sansa building the ice castle of or snow castle of Winterfell was a nice little thing there, because she hasn't seen snow in so long, nor her home. I felt this conversation between her and Robin was pretty okay. I did feel like the slap, and probably it was mainly probably due to how it was edited, was a bit out of nowhere as a reaction. I think like you could have waited on the slap a few more seconds, have her see, like, sink in, and then probably snap him maybe. But it did feel a bit out of nowhere, like as a reaction for Sansa. I don't know if that would be the first thing she does with that sort of
the editing was a bit clunky in that whole conversation.
It was. I definitely noticed that. It didn't feel natural, and the pacing was a little bit off with the whole. Yeah.
It's really difficult to basically try and get this kid to act as well, because he's clearly not old enough to really express the ways the other actors do.
You have to have really, really talented directors to get child actors to really perform, and they're very rare. So it's always going to be difficult. But yeah, I feel like there were bits there I felt could have been a bit more smoother. And other than that, I'm pretty fine with the last 10 minutes of the episode with Littlefinger, especially. I did pretty much predict the final scene as soon as it started, so that was pretty satisfying.
Yeah, and I love the sort of thing of Sansa thinks that she wants to punish her for the slap, but it was actually because of the kiss, and she thinks that Sansa kissed Peter rather than the other way around, because she's a crazy fucking lunatic. But basically, the implications of that now is that now that Lysa Arryn is removed from the equation, what does that mean for Littlefinger? Because now the Lords of the Vale are going to want to know what the fuck happened to her.
Oh, she just slipped. Yeah, Sansa, that's going to be interesting to pick up.
Sansa has witnessed a lot this episode, seeing not only having Littlefinger force himself onto her, but then seeing him kill a woman like that. Kill her aunt by pushing her through the moon door. It's quite traumatic to witness for her.
Yeah, it is, really. It's a lot. A lot to witness.
Yes, indeed. But I thought that Littlefinger was brilliant. I think him and Tyrion and Oberyn were my favourite things about this episode in terms of performances. I just loved that whole scene, though, when he was when he gave that sort of speech to Sansa and all that music played in the background. That was just...
Yeah.
That whole delivery was just so... It was weird because it was magically sympathetic and understandable, but it was also extremely psychopathic as well.
Yeah.
And there was a nuance in his performance I really noticed a lot, was that he was putting on that... You know how we've noticed how over the seasons from like 1 to 3 especially, his voice evolved from the sort of poshness that he was in season 1 to the sort of more sort of who he really is inside. Sort of like cunning, devious, almost.
He's as the show has gone, he's revealed more and more of his, I guess, true self.
And I noticed in this episode he did both voices. He did the old royal voice, but then he built up to the reality. You know, especially at the very end when he said, "There's only one woman I've loved in this world, your sister." Fantastic facial acting from Aidan Gillen, I thought.
Absolutely.
Really, really well done. He's one of the most, he's got one of the most uncomfortable faces as well. He just has this sort
of... He does. He's got a really good face for, like, this sort of character.
Yeah, you know what it almost reminds me of? It's like, you know, when a puppet's eyes are moving, but the face isn't. It's kind of like that. It's got that weird sort of uncanny valley look to it that he does, where his smile stays tattooed on his face, but his eyes move around and do the talking for him.
Absolutely, I would agree with that. Yeah, I really enjoy his performances pretty much every episode.
So yeah, Mockingbird received critical acclaim. It was seen as mostly sets the table for future events. It remains chock full of action, suspense, surprise, and raw human emotion. It certainly had raw human emotion with Lysa, Aaron. Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
You tried to kiss my Peter?
Yeah, you whore.
You whore, you look down? Yes, of course, it was written by David Benioff and D.B. Weiss. Some of it was a bit clunky. This certainly... Yeah. We're certainly getting to the point where, like, it's not that the overall narrative has shifted from the books, but they are just these scenes that don't exist, and they are having to write them, and you're getting these things that don't really happen. But at the same time, you get stuff like Oberyn and Tyrion, which is brilliant, and you get some of Littlefinger's dialogue, which is brilliant, and the stuff with Bronn, and the stuff with the Hound. So, you know, it really depends, I think, on which character they're handling. But they can be hit and miss when it comes to dialogue. But I think, as we've been saying, the cracks are showing with these two. It's just, when is it going to burst? Like, this episode didn't feel anywhere near as slick as the last one did. And the last one was written by Brian Cogman, who's a much more talented dialogue and character writer than they are. But I think... why their episodes in the early seasons worked so well was because of the adaptation. When they're adapting from George R. R. Martin, they can be brilliant with the dialogue, but it's just when they're having to create these scenarios that don't exist, it can be, depending on the production, it can be just sort of... Yeah, it's the showrunner syndrome of having to write too much television and not refining it, which is a problem, because I think this season they've had less writers than they usually have, which I think might be part of the issue. You know, like season 2, they had Vanessa Taylor for a couple of episodes, and season 1, they had like Jane Espenson, and that's kind of part of the issue, really. Whereas I think this season it's just them, and then like one episode by George R. R. Martin, and then 2 episodes by Brian Cogman, and that's it. And I think it kind of wears them thin. Especially given that it's starting to deviate a bit more than they usually do. So, yeah, that's a bit of a problem, but they, you know, I wouldn't say they've hit bad territory yet with their writing.
No. No, I wouldn't say that.
The direction was by Alex Sakharov. I think the color grading was probably the best thing about the episode, but I think the editing was probably the worst thing. In regards to the visuals. Like, it all had the right sort of aesthetic and lighting and vibrance, but some of the cuts were weird. Probably some of my favorite direction came in the prison cell scenes with Tyrion. I think that those are probably the best directed scenes.
I'd agree with that, yeah.
And also the bath scene with Melisandre and Celise Baratheon. But on the whole, it wasn't... I wouldn't say this was one of the best directed episodes of Game of Thrones.
Yeah, I probably agree.
Oh, actually, I will say I do think the scene with Littlefinger in the snow was definitely well shot. It had
that was good.
It almost had a like sort of surreal feeling to it. Actually, there was something about it that felt really different.
Well, we've never seen Littlefinger in a snow setting, so that was quite unique.
That is true, yeah. But there was something magical about it, almost. Like, there was a romantic feeling to it, even though the actual narrative is really dark. Littlefinger is sort of expressing, like, this is what I feel like love should be. And I couldn't have it with your mother, but I want to have it with you. Which is really fucking awful, but it's also... When you look at it from his perspective, this is him fulfilling his fantasy. That's what makes Littlefinger so unique. Like, can you really think of any other character in fiction that's like him? You know, he's just so defined and specific.
Not that comes to mind.
Because people say, you know, he's a chess player. It's like, that's true. But he's also has this massive weakness of arranged marriages fucking over his love life. And then also his revenge, you know, his murders come from, like, the murder of Jon Arryn was just purely for power, but then against Joffrey was out of personal hatred and revenge as well, and justice. So he has different motivations for the killing he does. It's not just about power, it's also about his personal sort of, I guess, his personal desire too. And what is that, like he said, he's like, I want everything. Much like what Varys said to Oberyn last episode as well. Which is why they're such a good match for each other. I mean, those two characters have definitely been very background this season, but the small bits they've gotten have been really good, I think.
Yeah. I'd agree.
Of course, we have music by Raymond Jarvedy. I thought he did a really good job this episode with the music.
I thought he was pretty excellent.
Yeah. The two tracks that we have, funnily enough, though, are actually from Season 1.
Oh my god.
So the reason why I've chosen the first one, which is Things I Do For Love, is because we got a scene with Littlefinger pushing Lysa Arryn through the moon door, so I thought that was a nice parallel to when Jaime pushed Bran through the window. So yes, we're going to flashback a bit to Season 1 with Things I Do For Love, which is the song that plays at the end of the first ever episode. How fun. Funnily enough, that also kind of ties in because Lysa Arryn sends Catelyn the letter about Jon Arryn in that episode too.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we just saw her last appearance.
Well, she fell too.
Oh, yeah. Indeed.
Are you ready? Littlefinger does for love.
Man, that brings me back.
Yeah. Yeah, it's interesting how comparing all these seasons, how the music has really evolved in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as soon as it started, I was like, oh yes, that is Game of Thrones season one. Like, I instantly recognized it.
Yeah, definitely.
I think maybe the main thing that he tends to change is the drums across every season. He seems to evolve a lot.
Yeah, seemingly, yeah.
Mm. But yes, I miss when Game of Thrones season one was like, you know, I miss when Game of Thrones was as good as it was in season one. Let's just say that.
Mm-hmm.
When literally every episode was like spotless television.
Pretty much.
Oh dear. Yeah. Back when it was like a proper adaptation of A Song of Ice and Fire, those are the days. Those are the bloody days. Funnily enough, the next one is also from season one, and it is called Game of Thrones.
Oh, that's the name of the show.
It is the name of the show. It's kind of like the full theme, I guess you could say. I also just remembered something, funnily enough, from season one as well. So, it just reminded me. Okay, so there's a thing in the Aerys storyline that we don't have that is in the books. And the reason why it's not in the show is because of what they do in season one. So, do you remember the bard called Marillion from season one? He plays songs to Catelyn, and then at the end of the season, Joffrey has his tongue cut out.
Oh, yes, I remember. He did. So
that's a TV show thing when he gets his tongue cut out. The reason why they did that was to sort of, I guess, quote unquote, kill off his character, even though he doesn't die. In the books, he is still part of the Aerys storyline going forward. And Lysa has Marillion play loudly, you know, play and sing loudly so that no one hears the screaming from Sansa. Of course, that doesn't happen in this, because Marillion's not there because he had his tongue cut out, and even if he was there, he couldn't sing. So that is one thing that they did cut, which does potentially beg a few questions. It's not necessarily a massive issue, but it could potentially be a contrivance if you believe that the Lords of the Vale could hear Sansa screaming. The other thing is that when Lysa Arryn is pushed in the book, she doesn't scream, and when she dies, she just sort of like is frozen in fright and just falls silently. So I guess the loud noise of people in that scene could alerting people near the Eyrie could present a few questionable implications going forward of like who heard, if anyone heard them. But I guess the inference you would have to make is that there was no one around that day. As opposed to in A Storm of Swords, when Marillion has still got his tongue and he sings loudly so that no one in the Eyrie can hear them. Because if you remember, you know, back in season one, the Eyrie was full of people. There were so many people around. The Lords of the Vale were there. Then you had the bloody prison guard as well with Tyrion. But with season four, it seems to be they're taking a much more minimalistic approach with it.
Seemingly, yeah.
Yeah, so that is a one notable change. But anyway, Raymond Jarvis's Game of Thrones theme again, nice. I think he played this in the closing credits of the first ever episode. It's like a slower version of the title track.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's a very slow, methodical version of the main title theme.
A notable bit of trivia is that Bronn is one of the few characters in the entire series whose fortunes are consistently getting better at the end of each novel/season. He's one of the only people that is actually climbing the ranks every season and not falling down. So as there's all these wars and all these murders and all this destruction and all this shit, you know, happening, he's just slowly gaining more wealth and power as he's surrounding himself by wealth and power, naturally. Which is kind of interesting because this episode also ties back to the Eyrie as well. Like, at you know, in season one, Bronn was merely a man who was at the service of Lysa Arryn, and now in this episode, Bronn is a lord of a castle and Lysa Arryn is dead. So how the tables have turned for him and her. The question of who do you think will end up on the Iron Throne at the end of the story is commonly asked about the series, and among the book fandom, Bronn's steady rise in power has led to a half-serious joke that at the rate he's going, he should be included on the shortlist of characters who might actually take the throne by the end of the story. Ben Hawke, who plays Hot Pie, explained that the production team wanted a direwolf-shaped bread that looked exactly right, because the joke is that it looks so much more neat than his last attempt. But it would have been wasted far too much time to just make another one after another until one turned out well enough to use. So, therefore, they actually baked something like 70 separate direwolf bread loaves all at once on the day of filming. They picked the one that they felt had turned out the best. 70. They made 70 of those. You remember the scene where they kill Roj and there's also a side character called Biter that gets his neck snapped?
Yes.
They're actually major characters in A Feast for Crows. They, there's an infamous sellsword company called the Brave Companions that is led by the character named Vargo Hoat, who I believe is the book version of Locke. But instead, of course, they put Locke as part of the Wall storyline in season 4 and they have him killed by Hodor. So, of course, instead of just having the Brave Companions be part of the show, they have Roj and Biter get killed in this episode because obviously Locke's dead. So he's not going to be part of that.
No.
That means that, and I imagine when we get to season 5 specifically, and maybe season 6, we may have to address this because, well, naturally, if Roj and Biter are, you know, major characters in one of the storylines in the fourth novel, being A Feast for Crows, then what is going to happen given that they're disappearance from the storyline happens here? Like, if Roj and Biter have been killed here, then what storyline they were going to be in after this point, what is that going to get replaced with? That's the question that you'll have to ask yourself going forward, that I'm sure we will address, because I know what storyline it's supposed to be part of, and I know, because it gets cut out, what happens to that storyline. And, yeah, when we get to season 5, I'll have things to say. Let's just say that. I guess maybe they just couldn't be asked to do Locke, Roj, and Biter in season 5, and they just decided to kill all of them off this season. It gave us a cool thing with Locke at Crastus Keep and the Wall storyline, but in terms of the other half of the Brave Companions, I think it was a bit of a waste just having them die here. I mean, they weren't even developed at all as characters, really. They were just sort of one note and then they got killed, and they could have done something with them, but they chose not to. So you know how I've talked to you before about how they they're sort of shuffling around the adaptation now, like they're going through everything's at different points in time. So you know, for example, like Tyrion's trial is in A Song of Swords and whatnot, like that's all the main focus of there, as is, you know, the Mance Rayder marching on the wall thing. But funnily enough, Brienne of Tarth's storyline at the moment is actually reaching near the end of the fourth novel, A Feast for Crows. So yeah, that's interesting. And also, like I mentioned, it wasn't in this episode, but the Bolton stuff with Reek is also already at the fifth novel with the Dance of Dragons. And the Eyrie stuff with Littlefinger killing Lysa Arryn happens right at the end of A Storm of Swords. So we've just hit the end of book 3 in that part of it. So yeah, we're definitely sort of getting, in terms of adaptation, we're jumping between book 3, 4, and 5 a lot at the moment, depending on where certain characters are in their storylines. It's possible that may be why, to some extent, things may feel tonally a bit disconnected in some episodes, because of how you're seeing bits of different books being spliced together. Oh my word, so Kate Dickie, who plays Lysa Arryn, is actually very afraid of heights. So it was a challenge when she had to film the scene. One of the cameras has to film her from below, looking up as she is hanging over the edge of the moon door, and the actual set, the distance between the moon door and the ground is still quite a long drop, and she even had to wear a harness to dangle in midair as the camera filmed her falling down the hole. Jesus. That sounds, that sounds scary. The things we do for Game of Thrones. Oberyn claims the mountain killed both of Elia's children. In the books, it was baby Aegon and Elia herself whom Gregor killed, and Rhaenys was killed by Aemery Locke. Aemery Lortress, is, I should say. You also may have noticed the absence of Illyn Payne since season 2 as well. You know, Illyn Payne, the one that beheaded Ned Stark.
Yeah.
The reason why is because the actor got cancer and he couldn't participate in the show. I mean, he's still alive now. He did, you know, reform, but he was supposed to be part of Jaime's storyline going forward. But yeah, they decided to cut him from the show because of the cancer, which is a real shame. They still have Podrick Payne, though. Up until this episode, both Clegane brothers were fully armored in all their scenes in the show. And then the mountain, despite that, he is shown shirtless here, and the Hound, after being bit by a biter, is seen tending to his wound. So this is the... it's kind of thematic in a way, because we see the Hound open up about his past. But in this episode, visually, we see both Clegane brothers without armor, which is interesting. You know, oh my god, this is a great bit of trivia. So you know the scene... It's interesting, because like we had the scene with Cersei, which was his last day of filming for the season, where he jumped in the water. This scene that he had with Tyrion was actually his first day of filming the cell. So he got off to a pretty damn good start.
Yeah, I'd certainly say so.
The snow model of Winterfell that Sansa makes was actually constructed by the props department out of Epsom and cooking salt. They had to make 6 copies of the model and for each to take, in which Sweet Robin destroys it. It's another funny bit of trivia is that it insinuates that Oberyn is a few years older than Tyrion, having remembered him as a baby, but in reality Peter Dinklage is 6 years older than Pedro Pascal, and also he's older than the actors who play Jaime and Cersei as well, even though he's supposed to be a younger character. Last time we saw the viewership dip to 6.4 after a 7.1 with First of His Name. This time the overnight viewing figures for Mockingbird was 7.2, the highest so far. I would imagine that Tyrion's trial might have something to do with that going viral.
Possibly.
But yeah, we got 7.2, the highest overnight figures so far for the show. Give your conclusion and rating out of 10 for Mockingbird.
Think there are some parts that I absolutely adore. I think there are some scenes that I really, really liked. But overall, I think most scenes had a glaring issue or two. So this is probably... Well, there were probably some really decent highs compared to last week. This was a step down to me, while still being pretty good overall. So I would probably say... I'm probably going to give us a 7.5 out of 10. I think there's parts of it that I'd really like, but there's other parts that did quite annoy me in some areas. It didn't really catch me like last episode. So yeah, probably my second least favorite episode of the season so far, but there's some stuff that I do really enjoy. Yeah, I think that's probably about fair.
That's the exact same number I had in my head too. I think the reason why I can't go below that is because nothing in this was as bad as the botched rape scene from Breaker of Chains.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Exactly, yeah.
And it genuinely did have that brilliant Bronn scene and the brilliant Oberyn scene and some really, really brilliant stuff with Littlefinger as well.
Agreed. You know, those were the highlights. So,
absolutely. The rest of it was... A lot of it was had good intent in mind with some of the character development stuff they did. The Melisandre Solis scene was quite nice, actually. But there was some... In everything else, there was just issues just leaking out. Like, all over the place, really. Which was a shame, because there's a lot of other stuff in the scenes that were quite good, too. But, you know, the stuff with, like, how they have basically killed off Rorge and Biter, and so they don't get the Brave Companion storyline. It's just sort of, like, just leaving that to dust. And then the sort of... The mountains reintroduction was fine, I guess. The Jaime and Tyrion thing had obviously the glaring issue of, well, why didn't he think of doing that? Because Tywin wouldn't allow Jaime to be killed by the mountain. And also, you know, I think the scene at the wall was fine, but nothing too special. And then, of course, Meereen being simplified once again, being only really beneficial to Jorah's character and nothing else. It's just not doing enough. I liked the Brienne Podrick hot pie stuff, but, you know, this show is capable of much better and has done much better in the past. So yeah, I'm also going to give this a 7.5. This is below the sort of peak era Game of Thrones standard, but it's not terrible. You know, it's still good, but I don't think it's good enough. You know, I expect better from this show than this episode. But yeah, the highlights were really good, though. I would be your champion.
Agreed.
Yeah. Following on from that, though, fittingly, next time is going to be Season 4, Episode 8, which is called The Mountain and the Viper. So, Your thoughts and anticipations going into The Mountain and the Viper.
Well, I imagine that'll be the fight, the trial by combat. Otherwise, it'd probably be a pretty misleading title. So, yeah. I think that'll probably be a big episode for King's Landing again, I would probably say. With this episode being the sort of in-between transition, naturally. So, yeah. I imagine that will probably be where the fight, trial by combat will happen. Other than that, not sure about everything else. Obviously, they'll probably be... Either they'll not reveal it until the episode after, but the sort of aftermath of the death at the Eyrie. That'll be interesting going forward, how that's going to turn out. Yeah, but everything else is going in a decent direction. Just, again, after last episode, just slightly slowing down a bit. But yeah, I still overall a good season with some big highs, but some pretty low lows. That's kind of been my thought for the last couple of episodes.
Yeah. It's just sad because you're just slowly witnessing the, you know, the thread being torn from the sheet, really. It's like, you know when you've got a bit of thread hanging off your shirt, and when you pull it, it just keeps going and going and it gets worse. It's like you're just slowly witnessing, you got this very nice shirt, but you're just slowly witnessing the thread being pulled, and eventually the shirt's just going to disintegrate.
Yeah.
Because we've had, what is it now? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 consecutive episodes with issues. The last time we didn't have that was probably The Line of the Rose, the episode where Joffrey died at the Purple Wedding. Every episode after that, there's been something not right about it. And that's a shame for Game of Thrones. This is the longest period of consecutive episodes so far where we've been like, oh, that's not right, that's not right, that bit's not right. Even with the highs that are there, you can just see that it's starting to lose its way a bit. And that's a problem. That's a shame.
Yeah.
But, you know, we'll have to wait and see how next time goes with The Mountain and the Viper. We also haven't seen, I think the one storyline we haven't seen in a while now is, well, two episodes ago was the Ramsay and Reek storyline. We haven't seen that since two episodes ago, so we'll have to wait and see if that pops up again in the next one, given the thing of Ramsay asking him to pretend to be Theon and go to Moat Cailin. So we'll have to see if that pops up. Mance Rayder marches on the wall. We've got Stannis has got the deal with the Iron Bank, and Melisandre is going to bring Shireen, and they're going to reconvene at some point somewhere. Daenerys in Meereen is going to do something to the Yunkai slave masters, give them a choice. What's that? What's the fallout of that going to be? Yeah, all sorts of stuff going on in the world of Westeros, and but obviously the main thing to focus on with the next episode is going to be the trial by combat between Oberyn Martell and Gregor Clegane, and the fallout of the death of Lysa Arryn, and how Littlefinger and Sansa are going to not only react to that, but what happens when there's an investigation, because she's a very important person. So, yeah, that'll be interesting. Any last thoughts before we wrap up?
I think that's sort of everything.
All right, then. We'll see you next time for the Mountain and the Viper. Bye-bye.